G'day guys, welcome back to the True Eagle YouTube channel for a preview of our big game against Collingwood at Marvel Stadium. Is it a big game in the context of the season? At the moment, every game feels like a big game. It's not necessarily a blockbuster clash, but I think every time we play Collingwood, there's an extra sense of intrigue. And for me as well, I can't help but be reminded of that time we beat them at Marvel in 2022 when we had a terrible team take the field that day. And so therefore, I've got this unjustified optimism about how this game's going to go. And I'm feeling excited for it in a way. I mean, there's a lot to be said for, you know, the players we're missing and how we probably, you know, aren't really as good a chance as we would be if we had Yeo and Waterman playing this week. And I'm feeling optimistic and excited for the game. And I think that might actually be more of a reflection of the fact that we don't have as much pressure on us this week. And I feel like there's a lower sense of expectation on how we're going to go. And I feel like that actually might serve us well. So for whatever reason, I'm feeling good about this coming week. I've done previews on this channel where I've been like, oh, let's talk about this game. But I'm looking forward to it. I am jet lagged as sin at the moment. I fell asleep at 6:30 a.m. this morning. So the chances of me being awake for 4 a.m. on what will be Sunday morning here in the UK, it's a 50-50 call at this point, but I'll do my best. So let's talk about Collingwood. They are in a pretty good patch of form at the moment. Some extenuating circumstances around their fitness and players they're missing, we'll get into that. But generally speaking, they have returned to much closer to the quality side that they were last year after a poor start to the season. So in their last five, we've got it here, they're undefeated. They've had one draw against Essendon, who we just lost to last week. Their wins have been over the Lions at the Gabba, Port Adelaide at the G. They beat Hawthorn narrowly, but they also beat Carlton in that time as well. So they've beaten quality opposition and have looked, you know, back to their best in terms of effort and intensity and pressure and tackling. And there's a lot of key stats they don't rank well in, but that's kind of the nature of this Collingwood side, despite being so good. Statistically, it's hard to get a read on exactly why they're so good. But either way, this will be a tough challenge. So quickly brush over what happened last time we met. We played them at Optus Stadium middle of last year. Again, probably in the middle of our pathetic patch, which lasted about 12 weeks. But, you know, we were outscored 4-0 at quarter time. And over the next two terms, we actually only lost by 2 points. It was 8-6 to 8-4. And we had, I want to say, I remember trying to follow this game on a Contiki bus. And I think we kicked like 4 or 5 in a row or something. It was an interesting game before we got absolutely poleaxed in the last quarter and ended up losing by 10 goals. But at the time, it was a relatively encouraging performance. I remember Tim Kelly playing well that day. Dom Sheed also loves Collingwood. 43 possessions and 10 clearances and I think a goal that day as well. And that continues a streak of not only the grand final, but a number of good performances he has against Collingwood. And we're going to need one of those this week with our midfield outs. Dacos also had 30-3. He is, you know, the talk of the town at the moment for his big performance against Carlton. So we'll talk a little bit about, you know, opposition watch and what's happening at Collingwood. They have a number of outs as well. I can't help but feel that during the coverage of this game, not to be a salty Eagles supporter and think there's Vic bias, but I'm guaranteeing that we hear all about Collingwood's outs and they will ignore the fact that we are also missing much of our best 22, but still some significant outs for them. Tom Mitchell, I think, has appendicitis. Jordan DeGoey won't play. Majacek is out with a hammy. Lockie Schultz, who hasn't been in the best form for Collingwood this year, is also going to miss. And I think McCreary's out too. And then there's a report on Jamie Elliott being in doubt, but he could still play. So that's five of their best 22 missing. And of course, we know the outs that we have as well. On a side note here, Nick Dacos is probably going to be playing mainly in the midfield, I'd imagine. He had 89% of centre bounces last week against Carlton, probably as a byproduct of the fact that they are missing Tom Mitchell and Jordan DeGoey from their on-ball rotation as well. And I imagine Jack Crisp as well will probably spend a bit of time in the midfield. So that's a bit of opposition watch for you. They're going pretty well. They're going pretty well, but their outs might just give us a chance of making this closer than what people are expecting. So we know the team news. I won't comment again on what is already oversaturated, but Elliot Yeo, we know, is out for a couple of weeks. Waterman concussion protocols. Sounds like his hammy's all right, but concussion protocols will rule him out of this week. We do know that Noah Long has done a PCL. Now, we don't know the time frame on that, but PCLs from memory, are a 4 to 8 week injury. And I think this will depend on whether he needs surgery, which was a direct quote. Somebody said we're waiting to see if he requires surgery, and that will dictate how long he's out for. So 4 to 8, if that's true, maybe closer to 8. Like, that's not too bad considering you know, I don't think there was ever a suggestion this was going to be a 1-2 weaker. We knew from the outset by the body language and the language and the verbiage used by the club and Simo and everyone, we knew this was probably going to be an ACL, MCL or PCL. So a PCL is a comparatively okay result. So hopefully, you know, he heals as quickly as possible. In positive news, Jaden Hunt is likely to be available. We obviously had no idea. He was a surprise omission last week, not on the injury list. And being reported by, I think, Ryan Daniels that he should play in this game, which is timely because we do need him. A short comment on Tyler Brockman as well. I don't really want to get stuck into the details here. A lot of innuendo and the club is deliberately being very tight-lipped about what's going on. So hopefully he's all right, but we can rule him out for playing at waffle or AFL level for a number of weeks, I'd imagine. So you can rule him out as a potential person to come in. So let's talk about the actual changes that we could see this week. Again, I think I'm going to release this day before the teams come out. So that's handy. But these are just my ideas. So Yo will be out, obviously, and Jaden Hunt comes in. That's not like for like, but I've got some ideas as to how we can manage the, you know, who takes the center bounce attendances in the absence of Yo. But I imagine Hunt comes on and plays in a wing role. Waterman for Marek seems the logical option. I don't really see any other candidates. I mean, there's Cully, probably plays a similar role, but I think Marek's a bit more equipped. Cully's still building his minutes. And Marek was out with illness last week, so hopefully he's all right. So that makes sense. That means we roll with a Darling, Williams, and Marek forward three. That's unfortunately the best we're equipped with Waterman and Allen back, out. So who replaces Noah Long is the more interesting one. Tyler Brockman would have been the logical one. Well, maybe not logical, but he's a somewhat obvious candidate, but he's unavailable. So this, in my opinion, throws up probably the biggest question mark over this week's selection. And, you know, I think there's two options here. We could go Tyrell Dewar. I think he's played all right so far in the waffle. Strikes me as a player who will play better the higher level he plays as well. It could be a good opportunity to debut him. The other one is Jermaine Jones, and there is a reason for that. I don't think he's been burning up the track. I think he has AFL level traits. I mean, I think he's got to tidy up his ball use for sure. But the reality is, if we're waiting for someone to put their hand up with an amazing performance in the waffle this week, well, we're just not seeing that in the waffle. So we just need to pick the right guy for the role. And we did see someone like Ari Edwards picked before he was necessarily earning it, and he played quite well and then played well in the waffle after that. So we're gonna have to conjure something like that this week. Jermaine Jones, the logic for that is if Jermaine Jones goes back and plays, you know, in a half back role this week, maybe Liam Duggan can spend more time at center bounces, and it doesn't really fix the forward line, you know, gap that Long creates, but maybe someone else goes forward or Jones plays forward. Jones has played forward, but because it's, I think the last time he played forward was like round two of 2023. I'm not sure that's the best option. My preference would probably be Tyrell Dewar, to be honest. And that means that we have the option of any of the following subs, Tyrell Dewar or Jermaine Jones, just depending on which one you go for. You could throw Harvey Johnston the sub role again, potentially. Chesser and Luke Edwards are probably the other candidates. Like I said, other candidates to come in, like in my opinion, Cully probably still needs to build some minutes. No point rushing him in. And, you know, Clay Hall probably still needs to keep developing the waffle. I think he had 18 possessions, 17 of them are handballs in the waffle. I feel like he's still got some development to do in the waffle. And, you know, I don't think he'd necessarily be the best option for trying to win this game as well. And we do need to try and win this game. So let's talk about team dynamics. Elliot Yeo comes out, Jaden Hunt comes in. I haven't necessarily nominated a genuine candidate to come in and spend the more time at center bounces. Duggan is one option. I think he attended 86% of center bounces in round one and has not attended one since. I think that's accurate. I think we're definitely going to see more of Ruben Jinbi at the coalface this week. He just had his press conference then. I just watched it. And he has spent most of this year on a wing. And he said he himself expects to play more at the center bounces this week. So that's probably, you know, the biggest solution. You know, Hunt comes in to take Jinbi's wing role. Jinbi comes into the center. Also, Sheed only attended 31% of center bounces last week. So that's less than a third. So in theory, you know, I know that there's a lot of anti-Dom Sheed sentiment at the moment, and I understand why. But in terms of, you know, fixing this gap in our team, maybe we give the keys to Sheed to play a little bit more time on ball this week, and maybe he thrives in that role. Petrocelli attended 76% of center bounces against the Gold Coast Suns, and then I don't think attended a single one the following week, but he's another option to take some midfield time there. So between Jinbi, Sheed, Duggan, and Petrocelli, there are some options there. Chesser has only attended one center bounce this season, which I found quite interesting. So that kind of implies it probably protecting him from that role, even though I do think longer term that might be the best spot for him. So that leaves our wing options as Jaden Hunt, Chesser, Luke Edwards, Harvey Johnston. Like I said, the forward line's not going to be, you know, as talented as we'd like. You know, we've got Jack Darling spearheading it and then Jack Williams and Ryan Marrick supporting him. Do you get the sense that our smalls and midfielders are going to have to hit the scoreboard this week for sure? Brady Hoff this week, the natural opponent for him is probably Bobby Hill. I don't know if it helps us that this isn't Marvel and I feel like there's less space on the ground for Bobby Hill to push high. Either way, I think Brady Hoff has shown a real good ability to shut down pretty much any opponent he's had this year. He just did it to Jake Stringer. He'd done it to Papley. Did it to Charlie Cameron last year. I think he had a good game against Waitman. Generally speaking, Brady Hoff has done a great job and I imagine Bobby Hill is the main man he will be opposed to this week. So that's how I see the team dynamics going. Those are the changes I would make. Prediction time. So if you are a subscriber of the True Footy YouTube channel, you may have seen that I've tipped Collingwood by about 39. What I think will dictate the margin here is how efficient in front of goal we can be. So the elephant in the room is that I think against Gold Coast, we scored 12 goals 3 and against Essendon, we scored 11 goals 5. So our efficiency in front of goal, our goal kicking accuracy has kind of kept us closer in games than some of the stat lines would suggest, particularly if you look at like inside 50 counts of both the last 2 weeks, it hasn't been good. I feel like this game has the potential to be close. Like I think if we play our best and play with a spirit of performance, we could keep this under 10 points. I honestly think there is a chance we play well. I still think we play well at Marvel, despite how, you know, round 3 against the Bulldogs went. I think what happened that day was our skill execution was so poor, but, you know, a lot of the other stats we were doing well in, I think contested ball was solid. I think our inside 50s and clearances were all pretty even. Could be remembering that wrong, but either way, I think we could play well this week, and what will dictate how much we lose by is how we can take our opportunities. And it's cliche, it's boring, it's not super predictive. But, you know, I suppose you could say that if we've kicked really well the last couple of weeks, we're probably due for a bad one. So I'm expecting a margin of anywhere between 10 and 40 points. But either way, I'm still looking forward to it. I think the less expectation, playing one of the benchmark teams at the comp, I probably rate Collingwood as the fourth best team in the comp right now. I'll do my power rankings on True Footy. Well, it might be up by the time you watch this. It'll be a tough test for us. Hopefully we see some growth from the younger players. I know that's, again, cliche, but, you know, we are in a position where, you know, Jinby's up to 25 games now. Chess is probably not far behind that. Accumulating the experience for these players, staying competitive, hopefully seeing these guys flourish in some exposed responsibility. Jinby's going to have like a lot more responsibility this week than we probably ideally like, but either way, I'm looking forward to it. Let me know in the comments what you think of, you know, the changes and what different changes you would make, or how do you see this game going. But anyway, guys, I appreciate you watching, I appreciate you being subscribed, and I'll see you in the next one. Cheers.